Changing the settings in your suspension has a huge effect on your bike's performance. You can make it more plush, responsive, or playful. A lot of these settings are fast and easy, while some take some more time. Today, we'll do a basic overview of the most common settings and what they do. Specifically, the ones you'll find on an air fork. The first setting that most riders are familiar with is air pressure, which you'll set up with a shock pump. Most forks come with a guide, which is based on rider weight, but that won't give you a perfect result. For that, you'll need to adjust your sag. When you sit on your bike, your fork compresses a bit, or at least it's supposed to. This is sag, and it's expressed as a percentage of the fork's total travel. Most trail and XC forks ride best with between 20 and 35% sag, but you should check with your manufacturer. The longer your travel, the more sag you'll likely need. You can determine your sag by sitting on your bike with all your gear on and pushing this ring to the bottom. When you get off, the position of the ring will indicate your sag. The pike even has a guide printed on the stanchion to make things easier. More sag makes your suspension feel plush, which helps you maintain control on chunky terrain. Less sag makes your fork more responsive, but that's only beneficial when the terrain is more moderate or flowy. If you like riding street, for instance, you can get away with very little sag. Even with proper sag, aggressive riders will sometimes find themselves bottoming out. Naturally, they add more pressure, which works at the expense of ride quality. There's a better way. These are called volume reducers, or tokens. The more of these you have in your fork, the less room there is for air. This makes your fork stiffen up towards the end of its travel. You'll hear people call this progressive travel. The opposite would be linear travel. Linear travel, or no volume reducers, would look like this. Green indicates the part of the fork's travel that's real supple and squishy, while red indicates firmness. As we reduce the volume, or add these expensive pieces of plastic, the travel becomes more progressive. Reducing your fork's volume is easy. Just order the right reducers for your fork, let all the pressure out, and install them on the top cap. Reinstall the top cap and pump the fork back up to pressure. If you're still bottoming out, reduce the volume more by adding more of these tokens. The next setting is the damper, or compression. You might know this dial as a lockout, or the charger on the pike. Simply put, compression controls how much the fork resists traveling. This can usually be done on the fly. Before a long climb, cranking this up provides a stiffer pedaling platform. For descending, you want to open it so that it's extra squishy. When you're doing a lot of pedaling on flat terrain, the middle setting can offer balance between pedaling and shock absorption. A lot of forks have a low-speed compression setting. This affects how it responds to braking and small bumps. If you find that your bike bobs around a lot while pedaling, or dips too much while braking, you might want to dial this up a bit. Don't turn it up more than you need though, as you still want your fork to absorb little bumps. Now for one of the most talked about settings, rebound damping. This controls how fast your fork returns after compressing. Close it up and your fork will return slowly. Open it up and it'll return quickly. I think a good way to set your rebound is to open it all the way and ride off some stuff. Are you getting bucked around when the fork returns? Close it a few clicks to reduce the rebound speed. You'll find that slower rebound makes drops feel really nice, but crank it up too much and it won't return fast enough for the next bump. Personally, I like my rebound on the faster side since it makes for a more responsive and playful ride. So now that we have a basic understanding of the settings on your fork, let's have some fun. We've seen a few clips of this guy throughout the video, and some of you might recognize him. Meet Clint Gibbs, a fellow YouTuber who races XC and cyclocross. Today, he was able to clock a time of 2 minutes and 58 seconds on this course here at Santos. I thought it would be fun to max out his compression and rebound and record his time again. First, we crank the compression all the way up, which makes the fork all but locked out. When sprinting and climbing, this would have been a benefit, but this course gets pretty chunky in some sections. For Clint, it was harder to maintain control in the rough sections and transfer power to the ground efficiently. In the end, he fell short of his fastest time by a full 9 seconds. That's a lot for such a short course, which shows how much of an advantage suspension really provides. Next, we closed up his rebound as much as it would go. Pretty hilarious, actually. Fox lets you close the rebound to a ridiculous level. This would be interesting. Surprise, surprise. Clint got the same time he did in the fully locked position.
Feels very similar to when the bike is fully locked out. The first hit is okay, but it packs up and it just felt so harsh.
With a slower rebound, your suspension doesn't have enough time to set up for consecutive bumps. So it keeps sinking lower and lower into its travel until it finally bottoms out. So what about fully open?
So now we're gonna go all the way out to number 0.
In this setting, there's nothing stopping the fork from returning. Like we saw, this can make the bike too bouncy and buck you around, but it didn't have much of an effect on Clint. His time was 2 minutes and 59 seconds, only 1 second slower than his fastest lap.
Yeah, the suspension felt really lively. It felt like I was using the suspension the way it's supposed to.
So, let's say you're dialing in your rebound and trying to decide between a click or two either way. According to our test, you might want to give the faster setting the benefit of the doubt. So, there you have it. My goal was to explain these settings without giving you information overload, but I know a lot of you guys like to get into more detail. For that, you might want to check out Clint's channel. He does long-form discussions on all sorts of stuff, like XC, cyclocross, geometry, you name it. I left some links to his videos in the description, as well as some charts, articles, and parts you can use to adjust your suspension. One thing I'd like to mention is that you can apply most everything we discussed today to your rear shock. We'll go over the specifics of that another time, but for now, I'd like to know about your setups. Leave a comment explaining how you like your suspension to feel and why. By the way, for all the beginners who've been asking what the settings are on my pike, here you go. Average sag, low volume, fast rebound, and very little low speed compression. That's as specific as I'm gonna get, because telling you exact PSI in clicks would totally undermine the point of this video. I want you to go out and dick around with your settings. You might learn something. Thanks for riding with me today, and I'll see you next time.